नमस्ते इवान, नमस्ते भारी आकाश तिवारी, एंड टुडे वी हैव मिस्टर विमल चंद्रन फाइनली आफ्टर 3 वीक्स. सो विमल, हाउ आर यू? व्हाट्स अप?
Yes, man, I'm good. Yes, finally after 3 weeks, postponing many times and finally, here.
Like Vimal, there are a lot of things you do and there are a lot of things we want to cover, but I just want to ask before starting the podcast, like, how many NFTs have you sold till now? And like, how much have you made from there? Like, I saw your WazirX collection, but I still want to hear from your mom.
See, currently in WazirX, I have sold three NFTs. I started minting in WazirX. So I think around 1,600 WazirX. So it's roughly about some,
Around 4 lakhs or something, I
six
calculated
lakhs
it.
might be, 6 lakh might be. Around 5 to 6 lakh, current value, today's value.
Why WazirX? Like, why WazirX? Did you like consider selling on OpenSea or any other platform?
I'll just explain you how did I start. Okay, I started looking into these NFTs when people had that big auction at Christie's and the Metacoin bought and all the huzz and buzz, everyone looking into the NFTs. So that's the time I just started looking at NFTs. I knew about the crypto before, but I have not jumped into it, or I didn't, give much attention to it. But when the art part connected to it, okay, what is it? I got interested in it and I start figuring it out. What is it all about? Initially, what I did is I got an invitation from a foundation, which is another marketplace. So at that time, once I got the foundation, I have no idea about the NFTs and stuff like that. I have some artwork, okay? I just minted it. I did a lot of mistake at that time. Okay, it was not the right artwork, and I don't know, how to transfer the crypto from the wallet to MetaMask and stuff like that. Okay, I spent a lot of money at that time. Okay,
It's a task, it's a
it's
task.
a task. So there is a learning curve. Then after putting it, then I realized, oh no, this is not the way to go forward it. So after that, I think after the 2 weeks or something, I burned it. Okay. So I thought okay, I will start from the scratch to understand what it is first. Then I started looking into the NFTs communities, what other artists and collectors are doing and how this actually works. And even I actually tried to understand what is crypto, what is Bitcoin, what is the decentralization and stuff like that. Then I realized, okay, if you want to mint something, that is actually a task. I mean, you need to really figure it out what you really want to communicate and stuff like that. So I thought some of my stories here. Then I thought okay, this is not really connected to global audience as first, because my stories are more rooted to India or my own native place. So at the similar time, the same time, the WazirX was coming up with the platform. So they sent me a mail, something like, "Are you interested to join in? We are covering up the platform." So I thought, why not? So that's why I waited for WazirX. One is my stories are much more rooted into India. So I thought, this series which I have, I think WazirX is the perfect match for that, to connect with the collectors or the audience.
Yeah, when you said it's a task about Meta, because when I was trying to understand this market, I was like, MetaMask, then there is Rarible, and there are so many platforms. Somewhere you need to put money to mint, somewhere you can mint
Correct, correct,
NFTs. What
correct.
is going on? I wanted to know, suppose, so you went on WazirX, okay, and now you're minting there. What is next? Like, now you started minting on WazirX and you're selling your NFTs there, but like, what is your next plan around NFT? Like, how are you gonna proceed now?
Oh, okay. Basically, I have other stories also. Okay, so I think I will also mint into other platforms. Okay, but I will take some time. I mean, I'm doing it slowly. I don't want to mint a lot of items and put it there. So now I'm, planning everything and taking it slowly, because there is no hurry. The NFTs are here to stay. So that's what my plan currently. So I'm not sure what I'm going to mint on other platform also. Currently, I'm just focused on the NFTs which I'm minting on WazirX, because I'm started the series. So I want to finish the series, then I move into the next artwork. So that's my plan.
Congratulations for the Times of India, man. Sci-fi, so story getting covered and
Yeah,
told.
it's a mint, actually, mint launch. They have put a front page,
So,
correct?
like, Vimal, this is one question which we ask to every artist, sportsperson, entrepreneur, everyone around us. Like, as an artist, like we covered NFTs, but like as an artist, how do you earn? Like completely as an artist, because you do photography, you do visual arts, except for NFTs also.
Yeah, correct, correct. So basically, I don't have a, you know, single stream of income. I have a diverse stream of income. Okay, I do photography. I do illustrations. Even I have my own store. Okay, so the income coming from different streams. Okay, one thing is like directly is that you commissioning some of the artwork, either with the brand or either with the person. That is one thing. And the next one is, okay, for example, if somebody asked me to do a children's book illustration, okay, so I can do that because I do illustration. Then another thing is that I have a store, online store, which sell lifestyle products. Name is Unpostal Letters, so that is happening every day. It's like a e-commerce site. And another thing is that I even collaborate with the brand, and I have an agreement with Vivo. It's going on for almost 3 years. They give me they're all the mobile phones, and I have to create photographs using that. That is one brand collaboration. There are other brand collaborations also. Sometimes it's a photography assignment. And I have also one of the founder of Ordinary Secret Films, which is an agency kind of a production house. So sometimes I will take, ad assignments also. So it's like it's very diverse, man. I mean, I don't want to get into one stream and get stuck with that. So now we have NFTs also. So that is another thing.
So yeah. My main reason to ask this is, na, especially in India, like when you tell your parents, like majority of them, if you say, I'm going to pursue art field now. So majority of the parents ask you, survive kaise karega? Like how are you going to survive? Or what is your next move? Like how are you going to survive it for 40 till 40 when you're 40, right? So I had no answer when they asked me, right? That's when I realized ki people don't know. If you're a 16-year-old guy, okay, you can still say, I can do a job because you know that job guy earns a salary. Yeah. But for an artist, you don't know, like, how do they make a living? So that question was still unanswered. That's the reason I keep asking, like, artists and everyone, like, how do you earn as a living? Because if people start watching this, they can, they know. Like, what is the next step? What are the different things? Like, as you said, you are so confident about different revenue streams. That's one thing which people do not talk about. Like even friends hardly talk about.
The thing is that, before I'm coming into art, I was in IT field. Okay. I was working as a software engineer. Okay. I was with Philips. Then I moved into Honeywell and stuff like that. So at that time, it's like, I have a good paycheck, I have a good paycheck. I mean, in a normal scenario, nobody want to leave that. But the thing is that the question that you ask, how you survive, your parents ask, I will survive there will be bank balance, but I'm not sure I will survive. Okay. So I thought like, okay, it's better to, get out of this, paycheck, that safety aspect of job. I want something much more challenging and something unpredictable. Okay, so all these things can happen, only you have that financial, ability to switch from one thing to other. I mean, I shouldn't say like, okay, tomorrow somebody should, quit the job and start doing this, So this financial stability is something that every creative should have to take some bold decision. So for example, I worked in about 7-8 years in IT field. So I had a good, balance, bank balance. So I can quit the job, so that's the thing. That's the thing about this. This financial stability is important. Otherwise, what will happen that you might have to take up each and every job, in the creative field. I mean, you cannot say no to the, you cannot say no to a client. You will take it up. So now it's like, okay, I have a good, I can survive for at least 6 months in Bangalore with all the house and all. Then only I quit the job. So I thought like, okay, if nobody give me any work, it's fine. I will chill. I will sit there and chill anyway. I worked for some 6-7 years. I need a break. Okay. So that's what I thought, but it started working out. I think it's better than I'm staying at a corporate IT job. That's how it is.
Especially during COVID, like a lot of people have started thinking about different revenue streams. And that is a good thing. That is a good idea about thinking about different revenue streams.
Correct, correct. The thing is that actually, to be very honest, the COVID thing didn't affect me much because I was always at home, man. I mean, I was working from home. What's the difference? I'm at the room. It was there, 5 years back also. So I was like, I was preparing for this time, this COVID time all along. So yeah, it didn't affect me much because I was doing all these things together. The only thing is that we cannot go out and shoot. But this time I did more of a work which is near to my native. You can see my brand collaboration, everything is happening near to my native. And a lot of illustration, now the NFTs and stuff. So yeah, it's actually diversification, not getting stuck with one particular stream.
Coming to the creative process,
Yeah.
okay, a lot of times you are mixing photography with visual arts and watercolors and stuff. Because you know so many things, how are you still able to not make a khichdi? Because you know a lot of things now. There are times when you think, I'll put this also, I'll put this also, I'll put this also in my artwork, and then it just gets ruined, right? Because you know a lot of things.
Yeah.
So there's this one setback of knowing a lot of things is that you have so much in your arsenal that you can put it so this, and sometimes the art doesn't require that much. Sometimes.
Okay, so I think it's because see, for me, I'm not looking at the medium first. I'm first looking at the idea, So for me, I take a lot of time not to execute it actually, not to fi what should I draw or what should I execute? I mean, what is the concept? I take a lot of time for that part. So once I decided, okay, I want to execute, okay, folk sci-fi, okay. So then I am asking myself, what is the best way to go forward? Is it a film or is it a photography or is it an illustration or is it a mix? So then only I am deciding the medium. First, I am coming up with an idea. So then I select one stream or mix two streams together, two medias together. That's my approach. So I think the idea dictate my medium. Yeah.
When I was seeing your Vivo work and when I saw your Lamborghini work, okay, it was like it blew my mind away. It was crazy from shoot to the concept to the every single thing, right? So whenever you're making a work, consciously you're doing a lot of things, right? But there are a few things which come to you subconsciously. And to build that subconscious part, what do you do that one thing that subconsciously helps your artwork?
As an artist or a creative, we all get inspired from things which is happening around us. Yes, you cannot just deny that fact. So the thing is that maybe it's happening subconsciously. Okay, I'm not sure about that. So maybe one day I go for a movie and I got moved by some of the dialogue. So I store it somewhere. I'm not sure about that. Okay. Then I read something later, okay, some poem or some novel. So I got some part, okay, this is really nice, and I store it somewhere, okay. So later, okay, I come to one particular place. It might be a random place near my native. Then I start connecting all these things, the movies or the art or the music or whatever experience I had. We put it together, we just connect it and create something out of it, out of our experience. The only thing is that you need to experience, or you need to have a lot of, if you have a lot of connection or you lot of experience, you have a lot of things to connect to. You have a lot of things to come up with. So that's the thing might be. I started with, all these sci-fi movies, started watching sci-fi movies. Another thing is I also like all this native folklores and stuff like that. When I was a kid, I used to watch that. Now, later when I start with an NFT, I'm coming with an idea, which is I connecting these two things, In between, I might have read some poems, okay, about how the folklores are done. And that poem also inspired. So it's a lot of things from here, and we all fuse it together like a DJ, remix the things. Yeah. So that's
So,
why, correct.
there's this one. So, I don't know if you know Jake Parker, he's
Yeah.
the founder of Inktober.
Yeah.
Inktober is one of the largest art community. So, he told me the same thing. Your experience makes you move. There's this one concept called as creative bank account, where the more experience you gain, the balance of your creative bank account goes up. Like there's this monetary bank balance, more you invest, more the bank balance goes up.
Correct.
For the creative bank account, the more you put in more experiences, your creative bank account will fill up more. And that's the same thing he said. Like,
it's same for everyone. I mean, it's not about being original. You cannot do something out of thin air, you know. You need to have something and you develop on top of that. The thing is that if you have more experience, okay, you went to Himalaya, you have all sort of different experience, or you went to some other countries, or you go back home, or you read something. It need not be related to art. You read physics book, okay? You got the relativity theory and you try to connect with it, and you read chemistry, you might come up with Breaking Bad. You know, it's all about connecting things together, you know. You need to get out of that comfort zone and find out something, find out something new. Then you try to connect with your other experience and you create something. It's the same thing for all the creative. This is what I think.
One thing I've noticed, you are very calm. Like in your artwork, it shows that you are a very calm person. And like, I am completely opposite to you. Like I'm super hyped and stuff. But like, I just want to know any moment yours where you were like super hyper.
Dude, usually I'm very calm, okay? So I'm very, you know, introvert. I don't want to, you know, meet a lot of people. If you say me, okay, I have an interview, I will postpone it at least 3 times before, like this, okay?
Yeah, it happened with us. It happened with us. Postponed 3 times.
Yeah, so I try to avoid contact with a lot of people. Okay, usually when we connect, okay, if we have something to say, something about all the movies and all the stuff, you know, all the something related to art, I'll get all excited, you know. I want to talk to the person, and I do that way also. And in between, the only thing I hate is like if people ask me to do something which I really don't want to do, you know, especially something
like this interview.
No, not this interview. Interview I want to do, man. Okay, so some you know this we take up some assignment, okay, and I do it in my way, okay, because I'm convinced myself. But there will be situations, it comes from a brand side or an agency side, okay, you want to change this to something very absurd, which I personally know, you know, this is not right. I really don't want to do that, okay? That's the only thing I get a bit irritated. But most of the time I just work it out, try to fit in. We cannot avoid that if you're working with you know, the brand or some agency and stuff like that. But that's the one thing I'm not really comfortable of. That's why I told, if you have that financial freedom to say no, okay, you can just walk away. I have done it before. Okay, because I really don't want to do it. So if I do it also, I'm not very honest. I'm just doing it for the sake of it. So I try to avoid that kind of situations. And that then also if somebody trying to force me, you know, I lose it. Okay. Yeah, but it happened very rarely. Usually I'm kind of okay.
Now I'm just imagining, I'm trying to imagining that, you know, how would Vimal look like this? Like,
yeah.
When he's irritated, like what would he react? It's so clueless. Like, I'm so clueless. How would you react? I couldn't imagine you.
Yeah.
That's the reason I asked this question. Like, I was like, I want to ask this question.
Yeah, but it happened. Yeah, it happened sometimes, but not regularly, sometimes.
Okay. So you have done a lot of brand collaborations, and few of the brands are very major. Like, you know, Lamborghini is like one of the super luxury brands, very well-known brands. Okay. So when you're in contact with such super luxury big brands, okay. So one, how do you get in contact with these big brands? And the second thing, how much bargaining power you have against these big brands? Like how much you can dictate around your creative liberty, around your monetary thing, how much you can dictate?
Yeah. So, the first thing, how did they contact? I did a collaboration with one of my friend Ajay for Vivo, which is a Monsoon record. So it was something, I was showcasing some of my monsoon moods near my native. So there are a lot of videos and photographs. It was there. I think Lamborghini was looking for somebody to represent India for one of their project which showcase the local culture as well as their designs, combining these two things. So they needed a photography, they needed a film, they also needed some illustration. So that's why they contacted me, because of the diversification. That's what I think. I'm not sure about that. That's what I think. They might have seen the videos and stuff like that. So once they sent me a mail, I didn't do anything specifically. The agency had sent me a mail. Are you interested in collaborating with Lamborghini? I said yes, I had. Then what happened is, like, I told them, see, the only problem is right now I am in Kerala. So if I can do something, I can only do here near my native. It's a remote place, actually. It's not very city kind of place here. They told, okay, they are ready to ship the car from Bangalore to here. I was surprised. So I came up with this concept of combining the different timelines.
Yeah,
you know,
future and past,
showcase their brand as well as showcase other local culture here in my native. It was a something different, because I got the vehicle here near my home, and so that was a good thing about it. Okay. Yeah, so that's what happened with the Lamborghini. And regarding the bargaining power, yes, actually it's difficult to say with the big brands. Okay, so you need to think it of as something. You need to leverage it in the sense, like, okay, this is a big brand. If you work with that, you can use that for your own good, right? Basically, other brands also look, okay, you work with this particular brand and you work with that brand. So, but you need to take a decision, okay, whether you need to go with them. Maybe some other brands might be there which you pay a lot, okay, but you might not have that much interest to work with them, okay?
Yeah.
So it's your personal choice whether to work with this brand or for a huge amount, or this one, okay, I like this brand, I'm okay to work with even for a lesser amount.
Nice.
Okay,
and also it also helps your portfolio, right?
yeah correct for a long run. Okay, so Lamborghini, everyone is like, say yes, you know, it's a kind of brand that everyone look up to, right? And getting the car here, and I can tell the story in my own way, which will be very different. And it was a global project also, showcasing the local culture and the design. So I was excited, and that's how it happened. And the bargaining power, it depends on the big brand. Usually they have their own terms and conditions, they have the brand guidelines, and even for Vivo or Uber or whichever other brand, whichever, they have the terms and conditions. Sometimes it fit in with your you know, things also. As a creative, most of the time what will happen, like when you get a good concept, you want to work on, you just jump in, you know. Okay, I want to work in even for the lesser amount.
You're super disappointed if they said no.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, so it's mostly like not a commercial work, it's mostly a collaboration, right? You also have a 50% of say. Okay, if I don't want to work like this, I can say them, okay, this is not really my type, because I'm not executing a brand's idea, we are just collaborating here. So 50-50, that's the thing. I try to get into that with other brands also. I had said no to big brands before also, because it might not work with some promotions and stuff like that, you know, because of the other reason that they might force me to do something which I really don't want to do. Yeah,
but for that you need financial stability.
Yeah, exactly. you need to have that financial stability to say no, and
yeah.
It's very important.
Yeah.
It's not really money aspect of it. It's also about the story that they want to convey. Sometimes the brand will come up with a stupid idea, you know. So at that time, I need to have that.
Sometimes.
Yeah. No. Yeah. I don't want to comment on that. Yeah.
I just want to say one thing, you know. So whenever you see an art, it's not completely like you'll understand it 100%. Okay.
Correct.
Sometimes
correct.
It can be like you'll understand it 80% or 50% or 90%. But what I loved about your projects was, like, once I was seeing your videos or any of your project, then I read the description and then I watch it again and I'm like, okay, this is one aspect more I could understand. Like that one puppetry thing, I had no idea about that puppetry thing. Traditional families. And I was like, shit. And I then watched him again and I was like, for me, then he became the idol of the whole video.
Yeah.
Right. It became like, I was like in awe with him. Like before I was like in awe with your art, but then I saw his thing and I was like, oh, okay, now I need to watch him carefully. So I love that thing about you, like how you keep your description and art both. So you explain it both, and I'm like, I loved it. Like how I can understand it more, and you know how detailed your work is. Like, man, how detailed. Like, please read his descriptions, guys. You'll see a lot of detail. Like, detailing meaning like a lot of small things which you keep in mind. I loved it, man.
So Akash, see, the thing is that I'm considering it, this one, not as an, you know, this is a photograph. It's not the photograph. It's a story that you are trying to communicate with somebody else. Yeah. It's that communication aspect. So yeah, the description is part of that. Sometimes the description may not be needed. You draw something and you put just the one line and allow the, you know, viewer to think about it. But the Kathakali puppetry, I really want to showcase that guy, you know, who is very famous in our area, and he's a local artist, and what he's doing is really amazing. It's very creative. So we felt like, okay, when that brand collaborations comes, I thought, like, I discussed with my friend and they told, okay, let's do with this guy, because people will read about it and he's very famous and he has traveled all around the world, Singapore, New Zealand, Japan, and normally the Indian people don't know about him. So thought this is a good thing to do for him. I like his work, so that's another thing.
That's what actually I misplaced my word. I just wanted to say that the way you communicate your stories now with your art and the thing, like, for me it can help me understand more. And I was like, every time I see your art, I loved it, then I see your description and then I try to understand the story and I'm like, oh, there's more to it.
Yeah,
that's what I love it. Like, you know, just so I'll just suggest people, like, whenever you see anyone's art, see the art, then see the description, and then see the art again. Like, you'll get to understand more such things.
Yeah.
And sir, I am done with the questions, and I think so. You don't need to like switch it on again your camera.
Yes.
Like, one last thing, like, how did you find this podcast? Just send feedback improvement for me.
Amazing, man. I mean, I like the curation of the people that you have interviewed and the sensible questions. So I think best wishes, man. Best wishes. I think this channel, right? The podcast channel, it's going to be big. I'm so super excited. It was super friendly, man. I talk this much, right? I usually won't talk this.
it's a big achievement for me.
Correct. It was super good. Super good. Yeah.
Okay. So Vimal, one last thing. Where do you see the NFT space now going? Like, do you think more platforms coming in from WazirX? Because like, I have this one theory. Like, obviously you are able to mint things on WazirX, but like, if you are going on different platforms, there is more pay also. Like,
Yeah.
So do you think it is safe for artists to directly jump there or no? Let's be safe by staying on WazirX.
No, actually, there are a lot of Indian artists who are very famous on other platform as well. Okay. Everyone started with the international platform. There are people there in Foundation, OpenSea, Maker's Place, and other platforms like Super Rare. Okay. There are people already there. A lot of Indian artists are there. Very talented people are there. And WazirX is something which is specific to India. They came up with an Indian platform. And for me, it's important, because if I want to tell a story which is more connected with India, I will go with the WazirX. You know, what they have done is a fantastic job. You know, they are trying to get not only artists, they are trying to get other musicians and poets, and they have other plans also, I guess. So NFT is not about just the visual art, you know. NFT is all about the token, you know. So it's more about different streams of people coming together with the token and with the scarcity of the token, all those stuff. So they have done a good job in that and created a wonderful platform. I think a lot of people might come back, showcase their artwork, which is growing, and nobody can ignore India as a marketplace, man. Nobody can, you know, particular point of time, India is one of the growing marketplace, you know. And by the meantime, the other platforms which give you, you know, better visibility to a global audience, as well as, you know, more income in that sense, and you can communicate and connect with there is a good community outside also in the global NFT community. You can talk to, you can see and watch and learn from other people, the other artists, all the Hollywood stars and Hollywood artists, and people work for big movies. And there are a lot of people, man, a lot of very creative people, and you get a lot of inspiration. That's the best aspect of it. So I try to, you know, watch people from different walks of life and different countries and their stories. So something what I felt like, okay, if what makes me different than others is only my stories. I have to be authentic to myself, right? So the thing is, Akash, what I thought about all this thing is like, see, even the technology has changed a lot. It's internet came, the social media has came, now the blockchain and the NFT, whatever came, the crux of it remains the same. I mean, the people want to communicate, you know. People like to tell the stories, and the somebody who started drawing on the caves, he might be trying to tell a story to other people, right? So over the year, all the evolution, everything happened, the crux is the same. People would like to listen to stories, and people live for that. I mean, what else we have? I mean, you grow up, you get some money, and after you all, you know, aged and you die. So it's when I think about this, it's very absurd, okay? I think something people hold on to is like listening to stories. If two people tells the same things, but it will be different, right? Because both of them have different experience in life. So that's what I believe in. Everyone has stories, but yours will be different because it's your story, you know?
Man, like this guy is crazy. Like when I was seeing your work, now you made me like pause, and I was like, I should look into my work, like what new I'm doing and what different I'm doing. Like genuinely I'm saying this, because once you get into this cycle of business, you're like, you must get this much money. And like after seeing your work, I was like, okay, Akash, you need to stop, breathe. Yeah. Like it was like, just breathe and see what articulation, how do you articulate more of your art, and in your what way are you visualizing it? And like, this guy is crazy. Like I was like, my team also, like when they saw your bro, like, okay, who's this guy? He's mad. Like he's crazy guy. Like, and I was like, shit, man, this is amazing. Thank you so much, Vimal, for doing this. Like, honestly, I'm saying it's not because you're my guest in our podcast, but you know, you just get connected to someone's work. Like inside, you're like, okay, it touched you from inside. It's a very big thing for an artist also. I'm so grateful to listen
from you. Okay, so thanks for hosting me. I mean, thanks for all the wonderful question. I had a good time.
Thank you so much for joining us, Vimal, and I hope so we meet someday.
Yeah. Kerala, yes, Mumbai. Yes, man, exactly. Yeah, best wishes.